Namaste. My name is MTS Nair and I am a retired executive director of a logistics company. After retirement, I ventured to learn art through the Bachelor of Fine Arts course in Bharatiyar University. The tales of two great epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, have been of quite interesting to me, and I have ventured to jot down a few paintings of few events under the heading Travel of My Brush. I request you to travel with me to view it and give your comments. Thank you.
Lord Vishnu reincarnated in 10 avatars of Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narsimha, Vamana, Parasurama, Rama, Balrama, Krishna, Kalki to restore cosmic order. Shri Rama, the avatar of morality and virtues. Lord Vishnu descended as a common man to uphold high ethical values and defeat the mighty King Ravana, who symbolizes evil and greed. Sita Devi is the reincarnation of Goddess Lakshmi. A cosmic aspiration, Sita Devi marries Shri Rama, the Supreme Being. Though part of a royal family, their lives are marred by unexpected difficulties such as exile into impoverished circumstances, abduction of Sita Devi by the evil Ravana. Despite their hardships, Sita Devi's life exemplifies courage, self-sacrifice and purity, while Rama embodies friendship, righteousness and dharma and defeats Ravana against all odds. Kaikeyi, daughter of King Ashwapati of Kakya, was the spouse of Dashratha, king of Ayodhya. A great warrior, Kaikeyi accompanied her husband Dashratha during wars. In a battle between Dashratha and Sambarasura, the former was heavily injured and the axle of his chariot broke, rendering him in a dangerous state. Kaikeyi inserted a finger as axle and drove the chariot, saving Dashratha's life. Dashratha offered her two boons to save his life. Later, Kaikeyi's mind was poisoned by Manthara, and she asked for her son Bharata to become king instead of Rama, and second, for Rama to be sent into exile to the forest for 14 years. Kaikeyi's wishes paved way for the fate of Ramayana. Agaliya, a woman of unparalleled beauty, was married to Rishi Gautama. Smitten by her, Indira tricks Gautama into leaving the latter's ashram early one morning only to disguise himself as Gautama and enter the ashram. The unsuspecting Agaliya accepts his advances, but the duo are seen by Rishi Gautama. He curses both Indira and Agaliya. Agaliya is cursed to become a stone and touch of Rama's feet is prophesied to be her Sabha Vimochana. Shri Rama passes through the desolate ashram of Gautama while traveling to King Janaka's court in Mithila. On Guru Vishwamitra's advice, Shri Rama considers Agaliya pure and unblemished and redeems her by touching her rock from with his feet. Agaliya rises as a beautiful maiden and worships Lord Rama, her savior. Janaka, king of Mithila, announced the Swayamvari of his daughter Sita and proclaims that Sita will be wed to the man which can lift and string the Shiva Dhanush, calling this feat Viryashulko. Cost to be paid by a suitor. Kings from various kingdoms including the mighty Ravana could not lift the Shiva Dhanush. Shri Rama seeks blessings from Guru Vishwamitra to perform the task in a bid to win Sita's hand. Rama effortlessly lifted the bow and strung it, breaking the dhanush into two. The sound that ensued was heard in all of the 14 worlds including Kailasa, abode of Lord Shiva. King Janaka gave his daughter's hand in marriage to Lord Rama that set into motion a string of events that led to the victory of good over evil. Prince Rama, embodiment of selflessness, wholeheartedly agreed to Kaikeyi's wishes of giving up this dutiful rights to the throne to his brother Bharata and spending 14 years in exile. As Sri Rama prepared for his visit, Sita Devi proclaimed that her Ayodhya is where Rama lives and set off with him. Lakshmana, as a dutiful brother, vowed to protect Sri Rama and Sita Devi and accompanied them. Vanavasa depicts the 14 years spent by the trio in the wilderness to abide by the wishes of Kaikeyi, whom he considered like his mother. A son unswayed in his virtues, stays true to his word to his father. A wife who boycotting all pleasures to be with her husband, and a brother who sacrifices his life as a prince to perform his duty as a caring brother. Vanavasa of Ramayana is an episode that teaches all of us of the values of life. Ravana, on hearing of Sita's beauty from his sister Shurpanakha, who was punished by the exiled Prince Rama and Lakshmana in the forest of Panchvati, decided to abduct Sita. Ravana sought the help of his uncle, Maricha, who transformed himself into a golden deer glittering with silver dots and captivated Sita's attention. On Sita's demand, Rama went in pursuit of the deer but soon figured out that its behavior was unnatural and evil. Rama shot down Maricha with an arrow, who cried out for help mimicking Rama's voice. Sita fell to the ruse and made Lakshmana go in search of Rama. On assuring that Sita was alone, Ravana kidnapped her, making Maricha play a small yet crucial role in Ramayana. Vali, brother of Sugriva, was a brave warrior with a boon to be able to take away half the strength of his opponent when confronted face to face. Sugriva was estranged and humiliated by Vali, ensuing a battle with demon Mayavi. Sri Rama and Lakshman in search of Sita reached Kishkinda and met Sugriva and Hanuman. Rama sought the help of Sugriva to find the whereabouts of Sita. Sugriva requested Rama to kill Vali in return for his help in rescuing Sita. Sugriva challenged Vali to a fight. When Vali sallied forth to meet the challenge, Rama emerged from the forest to shoot and kill him with an arrow from behind a tree. Vali Vadam is a very sentimental storyline in the epic Ramayana. Hanuman, ardent devotee of Sri Rama, set out in search of Sita Devi, realized that he is son of Vayu and became aware of his unlimited strength. He flew across the ocean and reached Lanka, where located Sita. He allowed himself to be caught to reach Ravana's courtroom. Ravana, infuriated with Hanuman, had come as a messenger of Rama, orders Vibhishna to set fire of Hanuman's tail. Having decided to have some fun, Hanuman shook off the rope with which he was tied and jumped from building to building, setting the entire Lanka ablaze with his tail. Hanuman met Sita Devi, bid her farewell and jumped across the sea to Sri Rama. In the face of insult from Kripacharya citing his lineage during a martial exhibition, Duryodhana immediately defended Karna by making him king of Anga. Karna pledged his allegiance and friendship to Duryodhana. The relationship that ensued is cited as the greatest of friendships in all of time. Once Bhanumati, wife of Duryodhana and Karna, were playing dice together when her pearl chain got entangled in Karna's hand and broke. The pearl scattered on the ground when Duryodhana walked in. In a sight which might look inappropriate to anyone, Karna and Bhanumati feared what might happen next. Duryodhana just smiled and started collecting the pearls one and by one, asking them to resume their game. He said, "Need I only collect or should I also chain the pearls?" Such was the trust Duryodhana had in his friend Karna. Pandit Parasurama was a master of archery and taught this skill of archery only to Brahmins and never to Kshatriyas. Karna was keen to learn from Parasurama and lied to the latter that he is a Brahmin. One day, as Parasurama was sleeping with his head resting on Karna's lap, a bee stung Karna's thigh. Despite the pain caused by the sting, which bore deeper into Karna's thigh causing him to bleed, Karna did not want to disturb Parasurama's sleep and quietly bore the pain without moving an inch. On waking up and seeing the blood, Parasurama overcame with his infamous rage as he realized Karna was not a Brahmin, since only a Kshatriya can tolerate such a torment. He cursed Karna, stating that Karna will forget his skill when he needs it the most. Karna could not use his Brahmastra in the Kurukshetra war because of this curse. Sisupala was the son of Sritashrava, sister of Vasudeva and Kunti. He was born with 3 eyes and 4 arms. While his parents were inclined to cast him, they were warned by a voice that said his superfluous body parts would disappear when a certain person took the child into his lap and that he would eventually die at the hands of that same person. As Krishna, Sisupala's cousin, took him in his lap, his excess parts disappeared. His mother pleaded with Krishna to spare his life until he commits 100 offenses. When Yudhishthira undertook Rajasuya Yagya, Krishna was invited as the chief guest. Sisupala, who hates Krishna for marrying Rukmini, whom he wanted to marry, started insulting Krishna, calling him a coward and worthless to be honored as a king. This was his 100th sin. When he insulted Krishna again, Krishna released his Sudarshana Chakra on Sisupala, killing him on the spot. Sisupala, who is considered to be the last birth of Vishnu's gatekeeper Jaya, attains salvation. The Pandavas invited Kauravas to attend the Rajasuya Yagya conducted by Yudhishthira at their palace in Indraprastha. The glorious palace was an unparalleled art creation of Maya. As Duryodhana was strolling around the palace, he was fooled by multiple illusions, such as illusion door that did not exist and hard floor looking like a water pool. As he progressed, he stepped on a wet carpet, only to realize too late that it was pond. As he fell into the water, he was laughed at and mocked by Draupadi, who claimed that the son of a blind man has also turned out to be blind. The enraged Duryodhana vowed to insult Draupadi that initiated a series of events leading to Kurukshetra war. Once a sage offered a fruit as a boon to King Brihadratha, whose 2 wives could not bear him a child. The king divided fruit and gave to his wives, who gave birth of 2 halves of a body. The king threw the 2 halves into a forest which was picked by Zara, Avandurga. The 2 halves came together, giving rise to a living boy, Jarasandha. Jarasandha created a great hurdle to Yudhishthira, who had to win over Jarasandha to successfully complete the Rajasuya Yagya. Krishna challenged him to a fight with Pandavas. Jarasandha chose Bhima. The 2 great wrestlers got involved in a brutal fight that almost took Jarasandha to death. However, Bhima could not kill. Krishna signaled with a twig to tear Jarasandha into 2 and throw each half into opposite directions. The mighty Bhima did so, and as the bodies were thrown in opposite directions, Jarasandha could not join them, marking his death. Abhimanyu, a brave warrior, was the son of Arjuna and Subhadra. When Abhimanyu was in his mother's womb, he heard about the Chakravyuha and gained the knowledge of entering the same. On the 13th day of Kurukshetra, Kauravas formed a Chakravyuha guarded at the Netri by Jayadratha. Arjuna, the only warrior who knew how to enter and exit a Chakravyuha, was distracted into another fight. Abhimanyu, with his half knowledge of knowing how to enter Chakravyuha, broke the Kauravas' formation to enter in. On account of his boon to hold Pandavas at bay for a day, Jayadratha stopped from the Pandavas from entering the Vyuha. All alone at the center of Vyuha, Abhimanyu waged a single-handed historic fight against the might Karna, Duryodhana, Dronacharya, Dushasana and many others. Having lost his chariot, bow and armor, Abhimanyu used to a chariot wheel to fight against everyone, eventually attained a brave death at the hands of Kauravas. On the penultimate day of the Kurukshetra that lasted for 18 days, Krishna and Arjuna fought furiously. Parasurama's curse made Karna forget the incarnations to strike Brahmastra, which could have caused the end of Arjuna. While advancing towards Arjuna, Karna's chariot was stuck in the ground as a result of his curse earlier from Goddess Earth. His charioteer of the day, King Shalya, refuses to take it out. Karna stepped out of the chariot to pull the wheel from the mud. As he dropped all his weapons onto the ground, Krishna asked Arjuna to attack Karna with his Anjalikastra, which was against the war ethics and dharma. A poor Brahmin's curse to Karna of him being attacked unarmed came true at that moment, killing Karna. It was the impact of the three curses that killed the brave Karna more than the Astra deployed by Arjuna. Bhishma Pitamaha, son of Shantanu, took a vow of celibacy to fulfill his father's wish of marrying Satyavati. He received a boon of Ichchamrityu, death at one's own wish by his father. During the Kurukshetra war, Pandavas knew that Bhishma cannot be killed in a direct fight. They plotted a plan to have Shikhandi face Bhishma, with Arjuna behind Shikhandi, knowing fully well that Bhishma's ethic would not allow him to attack Shikhandi, who was a woman in previous birth. Arjuna pelted multiple arrows into Bhishma's body with Shikhandi as cover. Fully speared with arrows, Bhishma fell on the ground. He requested a rest for his head and water to drink. Arjuna arranged both with his arrows. Bhishma lay on this bed of arrows for 58 days and attained the heavenly abode on the first day of Uttarayan as per his choice. On the last day of the Kurukshetra war, with his army reduced to himself, Ashwatthama, Kripa, and Kritvarma, Duryodhana went to meditate in a lake. When the Pandavas and Krishna eventually found him, Duryodhana was offered a chance to fight with any of the Pandavas with a weapon of his choice. Fighting his nemesis Bhima with the mace, the favorite weapon of the two warriors, was his choice. The brutal and long fight almost made Bhima faint. Krishna signaled Bhima by repeatedly clapping his thigh, which reminded Bhima of his oath to crush Duryodhana's thigh at the time of Draupadi Vastrabharana. Bhima attached Duryodhana in his thigh, which angered their guru Balrama to no ends, but ensured Duryodhana's end nevertheless. Duryodhana's death symbolizes the conclusion of the Kurukshetra war.
Trust you have enjoyed the paintings of my Ramayana and Mahabharata stories under the heading Travel of my Krish. There are many people who have been supporting to me for reaching to this stage. I wish to express my thanks and gratitude to my Guru, Sri R. Rajendran, Director of Design Academy. It is with his excellent teachings and personal guidance I was able to reach this point of achievement. I owe him to what for I am today. I am deeply grateful to Sri Shailesh Valade, he is a contemporary artist at Choramangalam Art Village, for his great inspiration and guidance. I also wish to thank my colleagues in the Bachelor of Arts. Without their great support, the entire course would not have become more interesting to continue. Let me mention very specifically about all my friends, family and well-wishers who have been of great support during the course and who have inspired me all the way. I have to specially thank the viewers for having spared their time to look at these paintings and now request and look forward to their valuable comments. Last but not the least, I would like to thank the World Art and Artists for making this display of exhibition possible. Thank you.